Finally, the year 251 has begun, a year that will make history as the pinnacle of the Gothic invasions of the 3rd century. Of course, there's a lot more to come, but most of it is due to what is going to transpire here. In this video, we'll take a look at the city of Philippopolis, modern Plovdiv in Bulgaria, part of Roman Thracia during these times. Last time we saw Gniva and his Gothic horde severely defeat Decius at Beroe, forcing him to leave for the north to reorganize and heal for almost an entire year. Meanwhile, Gniva has been all but quiet, going from here to there, sacking everything in his path. There was no great army to stop him after all. As I mentioned in previous videos, the Gothic warband was formed by several subtribes, led by Gniva on the west and by the mysterious Argythus and Gunteric on the east. They successfully executed a pincer movement with the right flank possibly unbothered, as most of either Decius's or Trebonianus Gallus's troops were stationed in the west of Moesia. So a siege began. Regarding the question of why Philippopolis exactly, and not the settlements on the coast, which were definitely richer, it's hard to tell. Having the knowledge that a pincer movement was successfully executed, we know that had they intended to sack Mesembria or even go towards Byzantium, like they'll do in the future years, they would probably have achieved much, as the governor of Thracia, a certain Titus Julius Priscus, was campaigning in St. Philippopolis at that exact moment. Maybe that's the reason for the siege, that they knew they'd find the governor there. It is, however, impossible to prove if Gniva had gotten there while Priscus was already there, or if Priscus had rushed to the city to attempt to protect it. What we do know is that 70,000 Goths were camping outside the walls of the fortified city, and that no relief force would come in the near future. Ilkas Ivan, writer of The Reign of Decius, proposes that, quote, Priscus's presence in Philippopolis suggests that before Decius had marched to Rome, he had deployed his forces in depth, so that he had posted some forces, possibly the Legio Quinta Macedonica with auxiliaries, at Philippopolis. In other words, this arrangement suggests the use of defense in depth well before its supposed adoption in the 4th century, unquote. I cannot confirm nor deny the use of defense in depth in this situation, as it is far from my field of expertise, if there's anything like that for myself. However, I do think that Priscus's action of remaining in Philippopolis was his own doing and not ordered by Decius, who was, as I remind the viewer, camping further north, readying himself for a second attack that he himself would carry, not Titus Julius Priscus. What transpired from this event was a siege that lasted at least 5 months, maybe 6 at maximum. We know this because previous events, like the siege of Nicopolis at Istrum, are given far less detail, showing that it was an extremely brief siege, and so this one has had to last at least a little bit longer, but not long enough for Decius to arrive in the field, as other sources will claim he was coming to the rescue. It is at this moment that Titus Julius Priscus appears in our sources for the first time, even though I've already mentioned his name before. Historian Zosimus completely ignores his figure in his new history, blaming all the failures of Decius in Trebonianus Gallus, but we know that that's just his own bias. It is possible, however, that he unknowingly mixed Gallus with Julius Priscus. Historian Jordanes does mention Priscus, and both historians live more or less at the same time, so Zosimus ignoring Priscus looks like an intended action rather than an unknowingly done action. What do we know about Priscus then? Well, not too much. He was the governor of Thracia and he had at least a legion under his command besieging Philippopolis. And that's all, really. His name does remind me of Gaius Julius Priscus and Marcus Julius Priscus. Julius Philippus, sorry, the late Emperor Philip the Arab. Is it possible that he was somehow related to them? There's not much distance in time, so it's not a completely wild assumption. We know that Philip had a tendency to put family members in command of armies and provinces, such as Severianus in Moesia or his brother in the east. Is it probable that Decius would have allowed Titus Julius Priscus to remain as governor of Thrace even after the death of Philip? 99% sure not. But we can never know, as the name of the governor of Thrace under Philip is unknown. Furthermore, I'll remind that Philip's brother's whereabouts are a mystery even today, as he suddenly disappears from records during his reign. So, is it possible that this Titus Julius was a nephew of, or something like that, of Priscus? We'll possibly never know, but I like to theorize. What we do know is that in an attempt to save his own life, possibly forced by the troops and civilians of inside Philippopolis, he was hoisted to the purple against Decius and forced to make a treaty of surrender with Cniva, who was awaiting outside the walls with his armies. Did he willingly proclaim himself emperor? I'm mostly sure that should he not have been in that tight situation, he wouldn't have. Immediately after signing some kind of flimsy alliance with the gods and opening the doors to the city, Cniva broke his path and murdered Priscus and sacked the city. It is said that Philippopolis had around 100,000 inhabitants at that time, being generous, and that almost half of them were killed in this siege, with the other half being taken as prisoners. It is after this event that Cniva finally began making his way north, back to the opposite shores of the Danube. But neither Decius nor Trebonianus Gallus would let him go away so easily, with deadly consequences for one of them. Or maybe both, as a farther in time consequence, who knows. And that would be all. Titus Julius Priscus's reputation has been forever damned as a traitor against Rome for allying himself with the barbarians. But we must always think that coins have two sides, as he had quite possibly no other option. In the next video, we'll finally take a look at the most reviewed topic of the 3rd century crisis, after literally anything Aurelian did, the Battle of Abritus.